This lesson is on complex fractions and rational equations. And the reason I put these together is because you take some similar steps with both types of problems. And those steps are 1, to find a common denominator, and 2, to multiply every piece shown by that common denominator. And so we're going to start with the complex fractions. A complex fraction just means that you have a fraction inside of a fraction. And so obviously number one, I have a little bitty fraction here and a little bitty fraction here, but the whole problem is a fraction. So that's why it's considered a complex fraction. And so I look at the little fractions. So I'm gonna look at this one and decide what the common denominator is. So this one's x, this one's y. The common denominator has to be x times y. I'm gonna multiply it by every piece. That's the second step. Okay, once you have it multiplied by every piece, you go to canceling out and making a new fraction. You're simplifying it. And the goal is to get rid of these little fractions. And so over here, when you multiply, you can cancel that common denominator with anything on the bottom. Not the top, but the bottom. And so what's left in this case is a 1 and a y. And so you do 1 times y, and that's just y. Then I have a plus, and then I come over here. There was nothing on the denominator of the 3 other than an understood 1, so I just have 3 times x times y. On the bottom, again, there was nothing under the 4 other than an understood 1, so I have 4 times x times y. And then I put my plus. And then I get to the 5, and I do have something that will cancel. I have a y that will cancel with this y. And that's going to leave me with 5x. Now, sometimes when you get to this step, you can cancel things out, or you can factor and cancel things out. Obviously, on the top, you have a GCF of y. And if you take it out, you get 1 plus 3x. On the bottom, you have a GCF of x, and you would have 4y plus 5. But that doesn't help us because I still couldn't cancel anything or get rid of anything. So I'm just going to leave it like this. I'm not going to take that GCF out because it doesn't really help me. Okay, now I have example 2, and it's a similar situation. I want to look at the denominators of all the little fractions. I just have more this time, so I have 4 of them. So I'm looking at these parts here, these denominators, to decide what I need to multiply by. And remember, the goal is to get them to cancel out, so it needs to be something that's going to make these cancel. So I definitely need 3 as my common denominator so that these will go away. And I definitely need an x squared and a y squared so that these will go away. The question then is, if that's my common denominator, is it going to get these? And it will, because obviously the x squared is taken care of. Here, this y will cancel with one of these y's. This represents 2y. This y squared represents 2y's. And this represents 1. So 1 will definitely get canceled by 2. Alright, so now that I have my common denominator, I'm going to multiply every piece by it. And I'm going to go to canceling out. Let me change color so we can see. Alright, so for my new fraction, these 3 should cancel, the x squareds cancel, and then I have 1 times y squared. Over here, the 3's cancel, the y squareds cancel, and I have 25 times x squared. On the bottom, I have the x squared canceling, and then, like I said, this y will cancel one of these y's, and usually what I do is just mark the exponent out to remind myself I lost one, but I still have one. And so I have 1 times 3 times y, so 3y. And then the last piece, the y squareds will cancel, and this x will cancel one of these x's. So I'm going to go ahead and mark that exponent out, remind myself that I still have one, and 5 times 3 is 15, and I have an x with that. So this is a situation where it will help for me to try to factor and cancel. I can already see the top is a difference of perfect squares. So that's going to factor to y minus 5x and y plus 5x. The bottom has a GCF of 3, so that'll leave me with y plus 5x. And then the y plus 5x's will cancel and leave me with y minus 5x over 3. And sometimes I may need that written like 1/3 y minus 5/3 x if I'm trying to deal with something linear. But this is okay for now too, just as long as you understand that you can rewrite it if you need to. Now example 3 is a little bit different. I have denominators that have pluses and minuses in them. And if that's the case, that means I can't just cancel up and down, like I couldn't cancel this x squared and this x anyway, because it's attached to the 9. And so if you can factor on these, you want to factor. So I'm going to start out by rewriting this problem and factoring what I can. The first denominator is a difference of perfect squares. So I'm going to have 5x over x minus 3, x plus 3. The second one stays the same because it doesn't factor. This bottom one stays the same. It doesn't factor. But this last one, I have 4 over, this has a GCF of 2. So 2x plus 3. Now, I have x plus 3 and x minus 3 that I'm going to need in my common denominator. But down here I have a 2. I want you to notice something before we go on. 4 and 2, when they're vertical like that, you can reduce those. So instead of trying to multiply everything by a common denominator that has a 2 in it, I'm going to reduce beforehand and make that a little easier. You can only do this because these reduce. So I'm going to erase. I'm going to say 4 over 2 is just a 2 on top. And that is going to make things a little bit easier. Working out the rest of the problem. If you didn't notice that and you still put the 2, that would be fine. You would still work the problem out the same way. It's just you would probably have to reduce in the end. You would have to take a GCF of 2 out of everything and reduce. So now my common denominator is x minus 3, x plus 3. And I can start canceling out. So I'm going to come down here, write my new stuff. So the x minus 3's cancel, the x plus 3's cancel, I get 5x. Just the x plus 3's cancel, I have 7 times x minus 3. Down here, just the x minus 3's cancel, I have 3 times x plus 3. And then the x plus 3's cancel, and I have 2 times x minus 3. Now you probably noticed that you could distribute the 7 in, and the 2 in, and the 3 in, and then be able to combine like terms. If you do that, you'll end up with 12x minus 21 over x plus 15. But I'm going to say for today, you can just stop right here. Because honestly, when you stop right here, I can tell what you multiplied by and how you got to this step. And it's going to be a little easier for me to check that you've done things correctly. I would hope that everybody can distribute and combine like terms at this point. So this is the part that I would really like to be able to check today. Okay, example 4 is going to be another one of those where we need to factor. And so I'm going to start with that denominator that's on top. And this is your trinomial factoring. And so if I'm doing that, I have a 9 here and a 6 here. And I'm asking what multiplies to get 9 that I can put together to get 6. So that would be 3 and 3. So I have x plus 3 and x plus 3. On the bottom, I have negative 5 over x plus 3 squared. And for our purposes, it's going to be easiest if we write that out twice instead of putting squared. And then I have 7 over just 1 x plus 3. So now my common denominator is clearly x plus 3, x plus 3. And once I have it with all the pieces, I can start canceling and writing my new fraction. So the x plus 3's both cancel, and I'm just left with 4x on top. Both of them cancel on the bottom with the negative 5. And then just one of the x plus 3's cancels here, and I have 7 times x plus 3. Again, this is a situation where it would be great if you stopped here because I could tell what you have done. If you do go ahead and distribute the 7 and combine like terms, you should get 4x over 7x plus 16. So, again, I would prefer this just to be able to check what you're doing. Okay, now we're going to move on to the rational equations, which means equations with fractions in them. And you use the same concept. So I look at my fractions, I decide what my common denominator is, and in this case it's 4x, and I'm going to multiply everything by 4x. Over here I'm going to cancel, that leaves me with 1. I can cancel the 4, that's going to leave me with 3 times x, and then I can cancel the x, and that's going to leave me with 7 times 4, which is 28. And that makes it a whole lot easier. You just have an equation to solve. So I'm going to subtract 1. So I have negative 3x equals 27, and then divide by negative 3, and I get negative 9. Now, when you get an answer, you always want to check and make sure that if you plugged it back into the denominators in the original problem, that it would not give you a 0. That's kind of a special situation if it does, and I'll have an example later on to show you what to do. But this one's okay because negative 9 is okay on the bottom of a fraction. Okay, with example 6, you'll notice the bottoms have pluses and minuses, so you want to factor. And I have 5, and I factor out a GCF of 2, so x minus 1. On the right side, the x squared minus 1 is a difference of perfect squares, so I have x minus 1 and x plus 1. And then, I'm always going to check this too, 5 and 2 doesn't reduce, so I'm just going to keep the 2 as part of the denominator that I need to multiply by. So I need 2, an x minus 1, and an x plus 1, so that everything will cancel. And then I can cancel the 2's and the x minus 1's, and that will leave me with 5 times x plus 1. Over here, I can cancel the x minus 1 and the x plus 1. That's going to leave me with 15 times 2. And instead of distributing the 5, you can actually go ahead and divide by it in this situation. So I'm going to divide by 5 and just have x plus 1 equals 6, and then subtract my 1 and x will equal 5. If I plug that into either of the denominators, I do not get a 0, so 5 is a good answer to have. Okay, example 7. Again, I look at my denominators. I need an x minus 2. This cannot get canceled by the x minus 2, so I need an additional 2. So I need 2 times x minus 2 for my common denominator. And then when I start to cancel, the x minus 2's cancel, and I'm left with the 2 times the x. Here the 2's cancel, I'm left with 1 times x minus 2. And then the x minus 2's canceled, and 2 times 2 is 4. Then I just go to solving. I have 2x equals x minus 2 plus 4. When I combine like terms over here, I get x plus 2. Subtract the x, I get 1x equals 2. Now, I've done all that work. Let's take that answer, plug it back in. If I plug that into the denominator in the original problem, I have 2 minus 2. Well, 2 minus 2 is 0, and that is not allowed. You cannot have a 0 on the bottom of a fraction. And so this is not actually the answer. The answer is no solution. This is called an extraneous solution. And what that means is it is a solution that you can get by doing the algebra, but it doesn't really work in the real world. So the algebra gave us this number, but it doesn't really work out because it violates the fact that you can't have 0 on the bottom of a fraction. Okay, here's our last example, and this one has a little bit of a different ending, so I definitely wanted to show you this one. Of course, we need to factor to begin with. So I have x over x minus 3. This middle one, the top doesn't factor, but the bottom does. It's your trial and error factoring, and it actually ends up to be x minus 3 and x plus 2. And the one on the far right does not factor. So I look at this and I decide, what am I going to multiply by? I need an x minus 3 and an x plus 2 for everything to cancel. Once you have everything multiplied by that common denominator, you can start to cancel. The x minus 3's cancel, and I have x times x plus 2. Then minus, everything here cancels. Be careful, anytime you have minus in front of a fraction and then something on top that is added or subtracted, put it in parentheses when you've canceled, because that minus applies to the entire thing. It means you need to distribute that in. So if I write it in parentheses down here, I will remember to do that. And so then my x plus 2's cancel over here, and I have 2 times x minus 3. Now, I want to distribute. So x times x is x squared. X times 2 is 2x. Distribute my negative in, I get negative 7x plus 6. Distribute my 2 in, I get 2x minus 6. Combine like terms. I have x squared minus 5x plus 6 equals 2x minus 6. Now, when you look at this, you see you have an x squared and an x in the problem. And there's really no way to combine those because you can't combine them. They're not like terms. It also should clue you in that this is a quadratic. So I'm going to subtract the 2x to get everything on one side and add the 6 for the same reason. So I have x squared minus 7x plus 12 and 0 on this right side. What that does is it allows me to solve this quadratic. You have to have a quadratic equal to 0 to be able to solve it. And there's different ways. There's factoring, and there's quadratic formula, and there's graphing. But I'm going to use factoring if it's available. Since this one has 12 here and negative 7 here, I can use a negative 3 times a negative 4, excuse me, to get the 12 and add to get the negative 7. So it will factor. So x minus 3, x minus 4. And then I set each one of those equal to 0. X minus 3 equals 0. X minus 4 equals 0. I get x equals 3 and x equals 4. Now, just like the other problems, I need to check and see, is either one of those a bad answer, an extraneous solution? So if we go back up, I had 3 and 4. If I obviously plug in 3, I'm going to get a 0 here. But if I plug in 4, I'm okay. And again, if I check these, I'm going to get a 0 on the bottom with the 3 here, but not the 4. This is okay with either one. But since the 3 is a problem in these two denominators, it's not part of the answer. So I'm going to come back down here and say, okay, 3 is not the answer. 4 is. 3 is considered an extraneous solution, but this is not a no solution problem because we did have one solution that worked, and that was the 4. Okay, and that concludes this lesson.